I would like to congratulate the team at UNIDO for choosing a very important topic for this year's industrial development report to focus on employment. I think this is one of the most important and fundamental issues for development. So yeah, it's great to see that this year's report has focused on sustaining employment growth through manufacturing and the structural change. And in my comments, I will focus on three topics. Next slide, please. I'll focus on the drivers of structural change, trade, foreign direct investment, technology and innovation, and the managerial capability. It is also great that that I noticed in this year's report that the UNIDO team has highlighted trade and foreign direct investment. And foreign direct investment as important external drivers of structural change. And also they highlighted the technology and innovation as a key driver for structural change. And also exciting for me to, when I read through their report, I noticed that they have highlighted managerial capabilities and the management the development in developing countries and their importance in industrialization, structural change, and employment growth. So this focus and this attention to management and the managerial capabilities is rare in the literature of developing studies. And this is actually one of a very important factor that has been missing in our previous system. And so I'm very glad to see the attention to this in this year's report. So for me, I will first talk about trade FDI as drivers of structural change and employment growth based on the Chinese experience. Next slide, please. Well, when we talk about employment growth, actually they are going together in many of the scenarios, together with output growth, structural change, industrial development. But in developing countries, especially in the low-income countries, they have land, they have unskilled labor, however, they lack of investment. Lack of the funding, because without this funding, this surplus labor and the land cannot form effective production capacity. For the countries, for the low-income countries which lack of development finance, foreign direct investment brings in a very important source of investment and funds that will go to the industrial sector and support industrial development. So it is financial resources plus the and unskilled labor in the developing countries plus their land all together form effective production capacity and allow the countries to produce better their domestic market and the international market and invest in international market. And then looking at China's development experience. Here I have brought in the bringing us back to China from late 1970s since the resort to year 2000. That is the period that China started to move out from agriculture-based, resource-based economy to an industrialized economy. So I think that period of experience of China is very relevant for the African and other low-income countries. And what we can see over that period is the fast growth to output in a very innovative sector, which records the township and the village enterprises. These are the enterprises, the industrial firms located in the villages and the townships in the rural area. They are absorbing the surplus labor from the agricultural sector and move them to the industrial sector, the manufacturing sector. And when we see the diagram, we can see, you know, how rapidly employment in the QVE sector, the township and the village enterprises sector, increased from the mid-1980s to the mid-1990s. That's 10 years. Some scholars call it like a miracle period. And the key to drive that employment growth is the forming of industrial capacity in the rural area. And the bottleneck to solve that industrial development, to solve the bottlenecks of the industrial development in the rural area is the attraction of foreign direct investment and opening up the sector to international trade. So many of the small firms in China producing textiles, footwear, apparel, or other, you know, labor-intensive products at a very competitive price, and they export the international market. The export output ratio in this sector is very high. It's very high. And what we have found through an empirical study, which was published, in 2005, in World Economy, we found significant contribution of exports and the FDI for the employment growth in the TVE sector, in the township and village sector in China. And this really showing how FDI and trade all together, working together with the surplus labor and the land, cheap land in the rural China, and the forming effective industrial production capacity and the leading to higher, fast economic and employment growth and transforming the country from an agriculture-based economy to an industrialized economy. Then let's move on to technology and innovation. Next slide, please. As Luther has already pointed out, technology could be a crucial key driver of structural change. And he already has explained how product innovation and process innovation can contribute to greater competitiveness and also bring up new markets and new demand for the brands. And what I want to highlight is the role of innovation in the low-income countries. Based on the case study, based on the ESRC funded, both program funded project on the diffusion of innovation in low income countries, that we carried out field work in Ghana, and it's surprising to some of the people who assume that innovation is not relevant for low income countries. What we found is very active, innovative activity taking place across a wide spectrum of industries in Ghana. And also, we observe many innovation also in the small and the medium enterprises. And the entrepreneurs told us that I survive because I innovate. Because they innovate, they survive, they grow, moving them, their firms to grow in the food processing and the apparel industry to cater the Ghana domestic market and the regional market in Africa. So this is one role of innovation in structural change. However, when we talk about technology and innovation for structural change, and especially for employment growth, I want to highlight, bring to everybody's attention one issue that we need to pay attention to, which is the technology choice, the choice of technology. To produce apparel, we can do very intensive way, employ 100 unskilled women to make the clothes manually. We can also use very capital intensive and skilled labor intensive technology and only employ 5-10 workers and use machines to produce the same amount of clothes per day. And the outcome is the same, however, the employment implication is different for different technologies. Labor in abundant countries, use labor intensive technology will create much more jobs, much more jobs. And the theory directed by, developed by Dan Osmoglu after directed technical change and the argument about appropriate technology suggests that technology will be only, you know, appropriate and efficient when we meet the specific economic, technical, social context of the location where the technology is used and for that exact period, time period. So, the issue for the African countries, for low-income countries, for Latin America is not only to promote technological progress and innovation, but also think about what type of technology and innovation that they need, especially to create jobs and employment. Actually, the technologies created in the South, in labor-intensive countries, will make the optimal use of the factor, which is labor, which is abundant in their country. And therefore, the technologies created in the South, like in China and in India and other, you know, Southeast Asia, Latin America, may be more appropriate than the traditional industrialized countries, the technologies created in those countries. For the other low-income countries, other developing countries. And actually, this highlights the importance of South-South engagement, economic engagement, South-South trade investment, and South-South collaboration. Through collaboration, through trade and foreign investment, for the developing countries to acquire and transfer more appropriate technology, but it's not labor saving, instead, which is labor augmenting and you know, job creating. So this is also one of the issues that we need to pay attention to when we think about the industrial policy, the trade policy in terms of technological progress, economic development, and job creation. Finally, I want to comment on the role of management capabilities and industrial development and hence job creation. Next slide, please.
Xiaolan, can I just may I just say a few things? The connection isn't that good at the moment, so I severely apologize for that.
The slide on FDI and the local managerial capabilities, the slide, the fifth slide.
Is it possible for you to finalize your presentation in about 1 or 2 minutes so that we can then try and connect you through the telephone, maybe?
This is the last, only the last two slides. Yeah, so I can finish in 2 minutes.
Have you finalized?
2 minutes.
2 minutes. Okay.
Can you hear me?
Okay, go ahead.
Yeah. I just want to highlight the importance of managerial capabilities building in developing countries. The research has suggested that actually the differences in management practices across countries is one of the main reason, driver of the cross-country productivity difference. And the research by Sutton and Kapenti in Ghana suggests that what the Ghanaian government left behind is not mainly technology. Actually, maintenance is that managerial capability left behind other more advanced countries. material, you know, technology and knowledge, where does it come from? And one of the effective transmission mechanisms is foreign direct investment. And the research looking at, you know, what happens in the UK, not even in an advanced country like the Britain, local firms benefited from knowledge transfer from multinationals on management practices. The more advanced management practice field diffused from multinationals to local firms. And also with our research of the diffusion of innovation in low-income countries funded by the DFID also suggests that observation, demonstration, imitation has been a very important channel for knowledge transfer. Next slide, please. And our research suggests that firms, you know, observe or heard the new products or process or new ways of management and marketing from other companies and they input directly or with some modification. So all these two, around 50% of the firms indicate that this is a very important source for their innovative idea, for their innovative idea. This suggests opening up trade and API, especially for direct investment, could be a very important vehicle for the transfer and the development of local managerial knowledge. That's all of my presentation. That's all of my comments.